You've done your towns, the ghost towns. You've done everything that you've done before. You've also done in black and white.
Yes, usually duplicate.
So your books have been done in color and black and white.
Right.
Have you never thought to use color and then have black and whites done from them, which I do?
Occasionally I have.
But
mostly when I'm taking the pictures, I see, I put on different glasses mm-hmm. and I see mm-hmm. in color.
Mm-hmm.
And then that picture works in color for me. Or I see in terms of grayscales. And I see differently.
Mm-hmm.
And I would take different pictures in color.
Yes. It's almost, I think it's possible to use color and turn out black and whites.
I know it is.
Yeah. And that should be another challenge. Talk about these two.
This is a...
The hands.
The hands. It's a very simple thing. I was at a workshop and with a lot of photographers and a lot of models, and everything was going on,
mm-hmm.
and somehow I just closed into a very, very simple detail.
Yes, yes.
And hands have been done 1,000 times. I mean, and there's 1,000 ways of doing it, but I enjoyed it.
Yes. You know, I think of a photographer, one man who taught photography, and he asked his students to bring in portraits. And one young man brought a foot.
A foot.
And he said that this was his fiancée's portrait. And it was more telling.
Really?
Yeah. Without fetishes, it was more telling to the teacher and the class than any portrait could have been.
And it's the feeling that the photographer brought to that subject, too.
What about this second photograph that we have?
That's actually the first nude that I had shot.
Mm-hmm.
And it was at a workshop that Edward Weston's son, Cole Weston, was
mm-hmm.
teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And it's combination of linear straight lines and the very
curve.
Voluptuous curves.
Yes.
And I liked it, and I worked a lot on getting the print just right and
mm-hmm.
so forth. And later on, someone told me that Imogene Cunningham had taken a picture very much like it.
We'll come back in a moment and go back to Cunningham.
Yeah.
Right. Bill Carter, you were talking about this feisty, feisty little woman, Cunningham.
Imogene Cunningham.
Yes, yes. Did you study with her?
No, I met her once in her 80s.
Uh-huh.
In a sense, that was enough study.
Yes.
I talked to her a little. I told her, she said, how long have you been taking pictures? She's a little thing, you know, with a little skull cap.
Yes, yes.
I said, that time about 15 years. She said, that's enough for, like, kindergarten, you know. You can start now.
But she was discovered and rediscovered in her 80s.
Yeah.
And she lived every minute of it.
She was wonderful.
Whom did you mentioned Ansel Adams. You studied with him.
I haven't studied with anyone. I read all of Ansel's books at the beginning.
Uh-huh.
And I self-taught as a photographer.
Yes.
But then I did do one workshop with Ansel just recently.
What is a workshop?
Oh, a lot of...
No. Was it a one-time thing?
It was
half
a one-time
hour,
thing.
Hour, three
no, it was
hours?
A two...
Two
it was
days?
About 8 days. It was
uh-huh.
a full week, day and night,
yes.
until 2 in the morning
yes.
sometimes.
Really?
Very intense.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of good people from all over the country.
What did it give you?
It gave me courage in a great way, you know. I mean, people like Adams and Weston kept doing their own thing as photographers for many, many years when the world never recognized photography as an art form or anything.
Yes.
Later, he's become famous and his things have sold. Weston never achieved any great fame in his own life, but he kept doing it.
Yes.
They kept to their own vision. That's the biggest thing I got from it. I mean, the technical stuff I've been doing for 20 years, I didn't learn a great deal on that score.
Mm-hmm. So what you got really was a kind of inspiration, a kind of drive to do what you've been doing. And not really to see through their eyes, but just to take from their goals and their drives.
Right, right. There's something invisible between a master and student.
Did you feel competitive when you were in this class?
No.
But you were a number of students.
Right, and a lot of them for professionals and advanced amateurs and so forth.
Yes.
No, it was wonderful to exchange ideas with people. People would come to me and ask me for one of my prints in exchange for one of theirs. And
really?
Then after we went home, we'd send them back and forth.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, in the old days, artists were in a cluster and they knew each other in a certain little community. These days, they're all over the country, all over the world.
Yes.
So it's nice to have a way of keeping in touch.
Yeah. Well, it's my loss. I've never belonged to any group. Now, this is an incredibly beautiful thing. This is the kind of thing I'd like the camera to go into, deeply into, and see it bit by bit. Tell about it.
Well, it's just a winter scene in Scotland, and the ground cover there is quite unique. And it's a very soft kind of print. And I was there. I had just come back from the heat of India, and it was very cold in Scotland.
Lord,
on the way back.
What, you know, it's difficult to tell what time, whether it was early, dawn, after sunset.
Late afternoon. This
was it
just
late?
Barely enough light left at all.
The light
photograph.
Is, it is so beautiful. What, when you see these things, are you able to gauge an exposure, or do you count on a meter?
In cases like this, I count on a meter, and then I bracket, because subtle differences in exposure on color, on transparency film, on Kodachrome, for example, which this is, a quarter of a stop one way can change the hue.
Yes, completely.
So I cover myself that way.
Mm-hmm.
You can never be precise.
You prefer using a transparency to a negative, a color negative.
Yes, I do. It's partly habit. Most of my work has been done for publications, and in the publications, the printers prefer to work from a transparency rather than from a color negative. And then the other reason is that it's more archival. It lasts longer. The transparent Kodachrome particularly has, they estimate, 50 to 100 year life, whereas the negatives will start to fade after 10, 20 years. But more it's just that it's like your piece of equipment you're used to.
I have some negatives that are well over 25. I started in 57, so that would be what, 26 years.
That's a long time.
And they're still excellent.
Well, I'm sure.
And I'm not very fussy about where they are or how they're kept.
Really?
Yeah. So I we don't know what archival is.
That's true.
And we don't know how long the Kodachrome will last, even though Kodak says archival.
Yeah. They have artificial tests of aging and all that, but who knows?
let's go to this one building. This
is in the Middle West. Actually, this reminds, my dad has a collection of Dutch painting, of 17th century Dutch, and I've been influenced by that. I've looked at his paintings a lot. And this particular picture reminds me of them. It's that kind of lighting and that kind of composition.
Yeah.
That's in the Middle West in Iowa, on the Turkey River. It's an old mill.
Yes. Sunset?
Sunset.
Yeah. You know, I must admit, I can't distinguish. If you see a print, I can't be certain that it was sunset or sunrise. I think the warmth is not too different.
No, it's true.
Yeah.
At different parts of the country or the world, that varies, you know. Yeah. There might be a lot of mist in the morning in California, but in the afternoon it's clear, that kind of thing.
Yes. Have you, I'm sure you have, you've taken pictures on the run.
Oh, for sure.
Shot from the hip and so on. Tell.
The worst one, you know, that's the paparazzi style, right? And it reminded me of the worst assignment I ever had. I had a job to stand on a street corner in the winter in London, in case Jackie Kennedy drove by on the way from the airport.
Good
for
Lord.
3 hours.
Oh, Lord. I hope it paid
with
well.
The windows closed and it's raining, and I'm supposed to take a flash picture of Jackie Kennedy. It paid. There was a job.
Did you get a picture?
She didn't come that way. Lucky for me, because I don't think I would.
What a shame.
Photography business.
Yeah. Now here's this is an abstract.
That's some rocks in Scotland looking straight down.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And this print was made by a very fine printer up in Venice, California, named Michael Wilder. And I found that there are printers and printers of color.
Yes, of course. But aren't they done under your supervision?
Printer, you go and talk to him. And
yes, of course.
You look at it in the enlarger, yes. And you get that exchange.
Yeah. It would be awful if the printer could not see through your eyes, because you have total control. They don't know what you saw in your original. You do. And by telling them what you want...
Right. That's part of the process, for sure.
Yeah. And this other is...
Some pine needles in a stream in the Sierras. And, you know, growing up in Los Angeles, from childhood onward, I loved to go to the mountains in the Sierras. It was like, that was the pure beauty thing. And that's a theme that's run through the entire career.
You will probably continue to do that.
Oh, absolutely. That's the source.
Bill, I can't tell you how much I've enjoyed this meeting and being permitted to see your great works.
Thank you so much.
I hope for the next two or three books you'll come back and we'll do more of them.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Come back next week for another of the artists.